Have you thought about free will?
I've thought about it. In fact, I thought about it even quite recently. First of all, I think it's a useless kind of thought because even though, you see, Stuart is very keen on free will because he says that the theory of microtubules and all that stuff gives a room for free will. See, maybe it does in a way, but you see, often people say, well, it's all determined anyway. I think people get a little bit confused. You see, I going back to my experiences I used to have when I was very young, and my younger brother was even younger, and he could always wallop me at this game, scissors, paper, stone. And I thought, how can he be walloping that game of chance?
Right.
So to make sure it was a game of chance that he couldn't wallop me at, I went into my father's study and I got out a book of logarithms and went into the middle of it and got out the string of numbers and produced which way you went by the string of numbers, followed it very carefully, and he couldn't beat me. So I thought, thank goodness, he's not reading my mind. It's just that he knows, gets recognizing patterns and things like that. He's good at that. Maybe even unconsciously. He recognizes patterns and he knows which way I'm going to do next because I'm not really being random. So it's not randomness.
Yes.
The free will is not randomness. So what is it? You see, I think it's probably, it's you're free to do something which may be very well determined. You see, you might, do I take course A or course B? You may be in some meeting, you see, which making decisions about some big plan. And you want to know, what is the consequence of doing A or B? Well, then you rely on your understanding of which is the right thing to do. So free will, it might be the same as somebody would do just by chance. That's not the point. The point is that you've used your consciousness as something to employ in making your decision. So that's what free will is for, in a sense. I don't know if I can say much more. And I also get impressed by things when I hear things about bees, and they're unbelievable.
Yeah.
And they seem to play...
They're unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Yes, well, they play football. There's some thing they were telling me about they're not trying to hunt for honey. They do things in little balls and they kick them around. There's some kind of football that they play. Why are they doing that? For fun? That would mean they have to be conscious, doesn't it? Maybe they are. I don't know. I don't have a view on this. I do believe that consciousness goes way down in the animal kingdom, sure.
Is the universe discrete or continuous?
I used to be very keen on discrete. I did it. Yes. People told me, I got to go into anecdotes. I'm too old. I just talk about anecdotes rather than the physics.
Okay.
If you want an anecdote, I can give you an anecdote. I used to be very keen on discreteness. There were two things in mathematics that I thought, oh, these are the nice things for physics ultimately to be based on. Combinatorial things or maybe complex numbers. And I think I sort of at that time thought combinatorial things.
I'm surprised if you came from algebraic geometry that you would be more keen to the finite side, the discrete side.
I probably was at that time. You see, I had a sort of gradual conversion. I think the conversion came with David Finkelstein. When, as he said after his talk, he gave this talk that Dennis Sharma took me to when I was a research fellow at St. John's in Cambridge. And we drove to London to hear this lecture given by David Finkelstein, which was on the Schwarzschild horizon, which is not a singular, is a horizon.
Sure.
And he described that. And I found that amazing. I thought it was very beautiful. At the end of the talk, I had a long chat with him about spin networks. So I described the spin networks to him. And he told me afterwards that this meeting, we swapped subjects. I did general relativity from then on, and he had been doing GR. He swapped onto combinatorics. I consider I got much the better deal. But that's, you see, I was thinking about combinatorial things, and spin networks were very much that kind of thing. Can you not think about the complex numbers which give you the directions of spin for a spin half particle, or do you instead think about this network, which is really the important thing, and the direction comes out of the network? No, that was, I was playing with that idea.
You said you've changed your tune now to be on the more continuous side or continuum side.
I just, well, the power of complex number, complex analysis was the other thing which had impressed me. And it's more drifted onto that side.
Do you think the continuous lies at the classical level and then the discreteness lies at the quantum one? Do you think that's the way to, quote unquote, unify them or harmonize them?
I wouldn't say anything like that as, I mean, maybe. There's something, well, obviously there's something discrete in quantum mechanics. I mean, something which people used to think was continuous, shock, shock, is actually discrete.
Now, speaking of what people used to think, you used to think that AI couldn't do what mathematicians do. Do you still hold that view because of their limitations, their formal systems?
In a certain sense, yes. I mean, you've got to be a little careful about these things. But I was hearing you just recently, I think it was on Zoom talk.
Yeah, the remarkable 0-1 model or 0-1 model of ChatGPT, yeah. What would be an example of something mathematical that you think a computer could never do this?
Well, it doesn't do anything. You see, you've got to tell him.
Well, even if you put it on play, you just press play and you say, generate for me some math. Because if it's the autoplay, that's the issue here. That's easily solvable.
I mean, there's a confusion, I think. I mean, it's also important to me. See, because one of the talks that I attended when I was a graduate student at Cambridge, nothing to do with what I was doing, was a talk by a man called Steen on mathematical logic. And I learned about notion of computability. I learned about the Gödel theorem. I found it stunning because what it told me, you want to prove something in mathematics? How is this statement? What the Gödel theorem says, it says, I am not provable by your methods. Yet I know it's true. Why do I know it's true? I know it's true by virtue of my belief that the proof procedures only give you truths.
There is the idea that people can brain upload. That is, they can take your consciousness and put it onto a computer.
No.
What are your views on that?
No, I'm saying no on that one, definitely. If a computer, when you say the word computer, you have to be saying what I mean by a computer and what Turing meant by a computer, which is a computational system. So if it's that, no is the answer.
Hmm.
If you're talking about a physical entity, which is not an animal or not a living being in our ordinary sense of the word, maybe. But it has to take advantage of what we're taking advantage of without even worrying about it, which is presumably, and here I'm going way outside of what I know, but I'm saying it's whatever the physics is which governs the collapse of the wave function.
Right.
Now, that is not quantum physics because quantum physics doesn't have an answer to that question.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.